Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.
What I'm going to do tonight is take you with me to the two prominent passages of Scripture that I go to not only to feed my faith, but just to remind me of how I got started. Because we started this thing, if you remember how you started it without deserving anything. If you think about what we were like before we got saved, we least deserved the forgiveness and the blessings of God at the moment we got saved. And yet as we walk with God, we begin to forget that we didn't deserve it to begin with. So then we begin to try to ooch back in. Y'all know what ooching is. We begin to ooch back in to trying to earn it, and then we go back to an old way of doing, which didn't save us to begin with. So I want to go to two places, Galatians 3. We're going to be just walking through Galatians chapter 3, several verses, and then we're going to end up in Romans 4. And usually when I'm ministering, when I'm opening my Bible and needing encouragement, I go to these two places, Galatians 3 and Romans 4. Now, Galatians 3 does not start out very nice. Let's just think that's just like that's that other church down the road, not us. O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? It was before your eyes that Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed as crucified. Let me ask you only this. Now, if you had a father or mother like mine, when they ask you only this, that was just the tip of the iceberg. That never meant it was just the only thing. It was just the main thing. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by hearing with faith? Now, he's asking them a rhetorical question to ponder. Did you receive the Spirit because you did something good and earned it? Or did you believe what you heard, and because of what you heard, you received the Spirit? So again, he's bringing us back to the foundations, bringing us back to the beginning. Are you so foolish, having begun by the Spirit, are you now being perfected by the flesh? Now listen to this process. He's basically saying you started this whole thing deserving it, absolutely not, but you heard something and you believed, and you got the Spirit. Now, if that's how you started, why are you going to try to be perfected another way? See, we start out in faith, but we always ooch back into trying to earn it and doing it on our own power. And that's me included, that's you. This is why we have to constantly come back to a counterintuitive way of life, which is called in the Scripture living by faith. Living by faith is not like any other religion. No other religion in the world basically says you are going to be made right with this God, not because of what you do, but because of what was done for you. And if you believe that, you are brought into right standing with God. No religion does that. Every religion on the face of the earth, it's about earning it. It's about karma. It's about, you know, sowing and reaping. It's always about you get what you sow. And not that there's not elements of that, but in terms of what brings us into favor with God is nothing that we do. And that doesn't make sense to our minds because we want to earn it. I got a couple of yes, two nods. I'll take that two yeah. Do I got a uh-huh anywhere? There we go. All right, I'll take that. Just get ready. Just again, appoint somebody on your row as a designated amener. I don't need but one per row. I need a verbal yes. This is like on the airlines. They say, can I get a yes? Yes, okay, good. Been appointed. It says, are you so foolish, having begun by the Spirit, we read this again, are you now being perfected by the flesh? And then he asks the second question. Did you suffer so many things in vain, if indeed it was in vain? Does he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you do so by the works of the law or by hearing with faith? So again, how do miracles happen? If you need a miracle, it's not like, well, what do I have to do? Do I have to go get the broomstick of the Wicked Witch of the West? Do I have to run a marathon, Sister Carol? Do I have to go earn it like that? Or do I simply do it the same way I got the Spirit? Do I do I hear something, believe it, and then a miracle happens? It's amazing to me that this is how simple it is. That's why when people say to me, well, I don't believe in miracles. I said, well, do you ever, or they said, we haven't seen miracles. I said, do you believe in it? No, we don't believe it in our church. Well, many times you won't be bothered with it. If you don't believe in the power of the Spirit and you don't preach it, then people don't hear it. If they don't hear about the Spirit, then they don't receive it. In Acts 19, when the apostles got to Ephesus, they said, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? And they said, we haven't even heard there is a Holy Spirit. So you have to hear something in order to believe it. How can they believe unless they've heard? So you have to hear something. Now, if you really stop and take inventory, if we ask ourselves, how much of God's word do we hear every day versus everybody else's word, then we would realize this massive amount, this avalanche of information that comes into us. And we wonder why our faith has such an effort kind of breaking through the ground. It's like all the other words are piling up because we're living in an information age. We're living in an age of words. And so we're plugged in all the time to words. But yet when we stop and realize, you know what, I'm hearing everybody else all day long and then one or two little brief moments of a quick Bible roulette where I flop the Bible open and maybe read a couple of verses, or I might sit down only to be distracted. Or if you have your Bible on your phone, then, you know, you're tempted to open up, when you open up your Bible app, well, there's Twitter, there's Instagram. You see, when I put that down and open up this, I've got 66 apps that I can open up, and rather than go to Twitter, I'm liable to go to the Isaiah app, you know, or the Malachi app, or the Revelation app, or Proverbs. So again, it's a competition for what we're going to listen to. Who you listen to the most will ultimately be will be the greatest factor in terms of deciding our destiny. Who do we listen to? There's a podcast that my kids listen to, my sons, and they told me about how these guys, I won't mention their name because I don't want you to go listen to it, but it's very popular, and they do crazy things. And one day they decided a few weeks ago they were going to tell their spiritual journey. And then they began to tell the story of having been worship leaders and full-time ministers on campus with a campus group and how they began to lose their faith. And then it's intended to be two guys that were kind of happy, you know, guys doing crazy stuff on the internet. Now it's deadly serious. And now they're talking. And so I began to listen to what they had to say. And then they recommended a book. And as I read this book that they recommended, just because I want to understand the pathology of unbelief, if you will. And they just began to listen to the wrong voices. And the voices that you listen to will ultimately be the deciding factor in your destiny. That's why Proverbs repeatedly says things like this: my son, my daughter, attend to my word. Incline your ear to my sayings. Jesus would go on to say, when he's describing his kingdom, he said, the kingdom of God is like a man that goes out and sows seed in the ground. And some seed falls on this type of ground, rocky ground, and some seed falls on ground with thorns. And that represents the condition of the heart of the people that the seed falls into. And he went on to describe it, and he said, be careful what you hear. For in the measure that you measure, it'll be measured back. So what we hear has everything to do with what ends up happening to us. Having begun by the Spirit, are you going to be perfected by the flesh? Does he who provide you with the Spirit and work miracles among you do it by the works of the law or by hearing with faith? Just as Abraham believed God, it was counted to him as righteousness. Know that it is those who are of faith who are the sons of Abraham or daughters. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, in you shall all the nations be blessed. So then those who are of faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. So wait a minute. If I have faith, then there's not just do I get saved, but there's another blessing. There's a blessing of Abraham. He says, so then those who are of faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. For all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone, be everyone who does not abide by all the things written in the book of the law to do them. In other words, do you know that the greatest burden we carry is trying to qualify for the blessing? Because if we're trying to qualify ourselves, if we're trying to earn it, we actually come under a curse. Cursed is everyone who tries to get this by the works of the law and you don't make it. It's a curse. What is a curse? You just read it in Deuteronomy 28. I mean, you see the blessing in Deuteronomy 28 that was promised, and then you see this curse, and the curse kind of comes upon you and overtakes you. So he said, cursed is everyone that does not abide by them. He says, for verse 10, for all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse. As it is written, cursed be everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law and do them. I've been so many times to Israel, and I've watched people that are far more righteous than I will ever be. If you want to say righteousness is being religious, they have got you beaten, hands down. The amount of times that they pray, they wear a shawl that has the 600 plus commandments, reminding them of all the commandments they have to keep. It is a rigid, dominating 24/7 lifestyle. From how you eat, to what you say, to where you go, to when you could work, to when you could not work. I mean, it is a dominating, religion can be an oppressive thing. And if you're going to try to do that, then it says, cursed is everyone that tries to earn it that way and doesn't make it. That's the curse. But it says, now it is evident that no one is justified before God by the law, for the righteous shall live by faith. But the law is not of faith. Rather, the one who does them shall live by them. And here it comes. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law, becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree, so that in Christ Jesus, the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles, that's us, so that we might receive the promise spirit, or one, it says, the promise of the spirit through faith. Say this out loud. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law so that the blessing of Abraham might come upon me. Now let's go back to verse 9. It says, so then those who are of faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. And it basically says that as we follow the faith of Abraham, what did Abraham do? Let's just go to Romans 4 and you'll see this. Again, these are the two places that are the most worn, like a path that are worn out in my mind in terms of, or in my spiritual life. Romans 4, now watch this. Look at verse 1 as Paul picks this up to the Romans, and he says, in verse 1, what shall we say was gained by Abraham, our father, according to the flesh? One translation says, what did Abraham find out? In other words, if we had a podcast of Abraham and he was describing his faith, what did Abraham learn? What he learned was, and here it goes to say, it says, for if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. Or you can brag on your religious accomplishments, but just not before God. And that's the only one that it counts. We can be impressed with one another, but ultimately, it only matters what he thinks. I'm trying to please him. He's the one that has the power to help. He's the one that is almighty, all powerful, all wise. So I can get a little bit of advice from you or a little bit of help from you, like the Beatles, a little help from my friends, but I need his help. So what did Abraham find out? It says Abraham found out that he couldn't be justified by himself. It says if he was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. Abraham believed God. Abraham simply said yes. Now, Abraham came from a family of idol worshipers. It says his father, Terah, worshipped idols. Abraham did not have the book of Romans to read. Abraham did not have a singing group to sing him songs. He did not have a church to go to. He had no place else to go. In fact, the only Bible that Abraham really got to read consistently was the stars of the heavens, when God said, your descendants will be as the stars of the heavens or the sand of the sea. So when I think about the odds against Abraham to come out of a background that had no faith predisposition and to be one of a kind, to come out of that background and then to begin to follow God, to follow this voice and to trust it without all of the things, without all of the testimonies that we have. I mean, when I think about the struggle of my faith and I think, look at the access to stories, to testimonies, to miracle stories, to Bible studies, to podcasts, my access to be encouraged is massive. Abraham had to hang on and trust with so little. And God counted him as righteous because of his faith. Now, to the one who works, his wages are not counted as a gift, but what is due. But to the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteousness. Just as David said of this blessing of the one to whom God counts righteousness apart from works. Blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Does anybody want that blessing? Hallelujah. Let me just pause and just praise God for a minute. Lord, I thank you that I am blessed because my lawless deeds are forgiven. My sins are covered. Look at the second part. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord will not count his sin. Think about it. You get blessed for trusting God to not count your sin against you. You know, Peter came to Jesus one time and he said, Lord, how many times do I have to forgive? Is it seven times? See, Peter was a counter. See, Peter had something happen to him eight times, and so he was just going to make sure that, you know, it was only seven. You know, this is all I can stand. I can't stand no more. And Jesus said, no, Peter, it's not seven. It's seven times 70 every day. You see, if you're going to be a counter, you're not going to be able to win that way. But you know what hit me one day when I thought about that? I thought, wait a minute. If Jesus asked me to forgive seven times 70, he would not ask me to do something that he himself was not willing to do. That's how gracious he is. That's why he says, as he taught us to pray, forgive us our debts as we forgive those who are indebted to us. Really, the only thing that we're really required to do ultimately, not only are we sorry for our sins, we ask for forgiveness, but we turn and we forgive others that are indebted to us. That's pretty easy. In fact, if you believe that, you just go look for somebody to mess with you so you could forgive them. You know, insult me, call me a name. Why? Because I need to forgive somebody. I haven't forgiven enough people today, so go ahead and just, you know, take your shot. I pre-forgive you. Go down to verse 13. This is where Pastor JT, hand me a water, if you would. One that's not been there for a couple of weeks. Now watch this. We're talking about the faith of Abraham. It says that if we follow the faith of Abraham, Abraham believed God and it was counted to him as righteous, that Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law. And if you really want to show what you're redeemed from, just go down Deuteronomy 28 and look at all of the curse. And you want to just be, you want to get blessed, you want to get encouraged, look at what you don't have to bear because of what Christ did. But it says we're to follow the faith of Abraham. So how did Abraham believe? We know that the Bible says he believed God, but this gets us a little more detail. Look at verse 13 of Romans 4. For the promise to Abraham and his offspring, that he would be heir of the world, did not come through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. Now, remember, righteousness is a standing with God. My children, my daughter Louisa, she doesn't wonder whether she is a Brooks every day. She doesn't wake up and wonder, does she have the ability to come back into the house, or does she have to knock and are the locks changed? You see, when you are in right standing with God, you are given, you're righteous. You are given a standing. You are made righteous. America has a Bill of Rights. And all you have to get is that citizenship card, and you now, no matter who you are, no matter where you came from, no matter what color, religion, or anything, if you are a citizen, you have been given a right standing, and you have a Bill of Rights. You have rights. How much more should we be trying to get this righteousness? How do I get this? Far greater than getting an American citizenship is to be able to get this kind of righteousness. So I want to be able to not have to stand at the back of the line and wait to earn anything from God. Because if you're going to try to earn your way to God, you got a long wait. That's the longest line that never, never shortens. In fact, the line to get to God on the basis of our efforts just keeps getting further and further away. I had this thought in my mind one day. It's like, if I'm coming to God just because I've got needs, I got a long wait, because as many needs as I've got, if you count up the needs of the planet, man, there are people far. I mean, half the planet lives on less than $2 a day. I mean, no matter how difficult our circumstances, none of us qualify for the most destitute and needy of the planet. But yet, that doesn't mean that our blessing takes it away from somebody else, because God is infinite. He has enough to bless every man, woman, child, boy, girl, dog, cat, mouse, any creature on the planet. We all have access to him, and he levels the playing field by saying, everyone has access to me, whoever will call upon my name, say whoever, whoever calls upon my name will be saved. Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be delivered. God so loved the world that whosoever believes in him. And so that whosoever means that whosoever, that means us. We just have been given a great opportunity because of all that we've known. The promise to Abraham and his offspring that he would be heir of the world did not come through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. You see, just like righteousness is a gift, faith is a gift. The very faith he's requiring of us, he's actually given it to us. I mean, this is the biggest setup in the world. This is easier than T-ball. This is easier than I mean, you're talking about feeding the answers. You know, one baseball team they're thinking to disqualify them because they stole the signs. In the World Series, we don't have to mention that team. We don't, but you know who they are if you've been watching the news. But listen, God's given us the signs. God's given us the clues. We don't have to steal them. They're a gift. It says, let's go to verse 15. For the law brings about wrath, but where there is no law, there is no transgression. That is why it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his offspring, not only to those who adhere to the law, not just the Jews, but to the one who shares the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. So again, we're building to this place of, let's look at how Abraham believed. It's going to give us insight into his psyche and how he did it. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. Now watch this. Abram, his name was Abram. His name meant father of many. And when God spoke to Abraham, he said, here was what he told him. He said, I am going to bless you and I'm going to multiply you. And then he said, I'm going to make your name Abraham, which meant father of many nations. So God called Abraham something before he could see it. God said, I have made you a father of many nations. I've made you this. Abraham still has no child. Abraham has to look at it. He's getting old. He's looking at his body. He's looking at his wife. But God has already said, I've made you something. So Abraham had to believe something that he could not see. Abraham had to trust something that he could not feel. So when the Bible says he has made us righteous, then we start to consult and say, well, I don't really feel righteous. He's made us a blessing. He's blessed us, but I don't feel blessed. You see, God does something by speaking and gives us a chance to believe it before we actually see it. But Abraham was a father of many nations with no child. Now let it sink in, because that doesn't make sense to our minds. Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. All right? Now let's keep going. It says, he gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. Now watch this. In hope against hope, verse 18, he believed that he should become the father of many nations. In hope against hope, he believed. In hope against hope. What does that mean? In hope against hope. In hope against hope. Huh? Mario, in hope against hope. Huh? How many have ever had hope against them? What does it mean when hope is against you? It means everything that you can see says there's no hope. Everything that Abraham could see told him it's not true. In hope, he believed against hope. See, when natural hope is against you, that's when you need another source of hope. You see, there is another source of hope than what we can see, because all of our hope, you see, if we get down to it, we really base a lot of our hope and then ultimately our faith on physical clues that give us encouragement. If something looks good in the natural and we put our thumb in the air and feel the wind blowing in the right direction, hey, I got some hope here. Well, what if the wind's blowing against you? Now we lose our hope. If circumstances look bad, our faith goes down because our hope goes down. See, hope and faith are connected. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. So hope is like the blueprint from which you can build your faith from. So if all of a sudden your hope begins to diminish, then hope is the foundation that faith can build from. So hope has to go first. When hope goes first, faith will follow. In hope, against hope, he believed. I don't mind being stared at. It happens to me every day. People just stare at me everywhere I go. When I'm especially on campuses, they just sit there and blink their eyes at me. I don't get any response on secular campuses when I go, so I'm getting a lot more than I'm normally getting. But it says, in hope against hope, he believed that he should become the father of many nations. See, everything you and I need to become, we're going to have to pass through that place in that moment where it looks hopeless. And it's at that moment that most people quit, because they don't see. They give up on God because a prayer wasn't answered. As if it comes down to one specific situation, whether they're going to believe in God or not. They put God to the test like that, when many times there was something even bigger coming. In fact, I've told so many people, I said, it's almost like a football game where the closer you get to the goal line, the more the enemies seem to stack up. And how many people have quit right at the threshold of victory? Just one more step. Just one more. Just, Lord, I don't see where it's coming. I have no idea where it's coming from. And I'm just going to stand here and I'm going to trust you that no matter what it looks like, I am trusting you. I am trusting you, God. I don't understand it. I don't understand it, but I'm going to trust you. Now, how did Abraham do it? Here it comes. In hope against hope, he believed that he should become the father of many nations. As it had been told, so shall your offspring be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body. Now, one translation, the King James, The King James is the only translation that says Abraham considered not his own body. That's not the right translation. Every manuscript, basically, in most translations, say that Abraham considered his body. If you have symptoms in your body, you consider them. If you have situations, it's not that you're in denial. Okay? I went to Egypt with a friend of mine and landed, and we're in Cairo. We went into, there was the Nile River, and I just told my friend, I said, look, I'm going to get in this little boat. They had boat rides, and I want you to take my picture so you can show people that I was in denial. You know, there I am. Bad joke, it's all I had, but I did it. Okay, that happened. But we don't get into denial of the circumstances. Abraham considered his own body. Abraham looked at his own body. Now, Abraham is about 99 years old. He considered his own body, which was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old. And when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb, so then he looks, so where's Abraham going to get the hope from? It's not like, well, man, I've got a new vitamin, and I've got, you know, there's a new thing, I'm doing some intermittent fasting, and I'm working out. And so I got some hope going here, you know, and my wife, she's been going to the spa too. Look at her. No, he looked at his body. He looked at her. And the more he considered that, though he considered how impossible it looked, where did Abraham get hope when hope was against him? Watch this. It says, no unbelief made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, fully convinced that God was able to do what he promised. So what Abraham did was he considered the promise more than his situation. Now, it sounds simple, but as I started out tonight, I said, I'm going to take you to the two passages that I spend more time in than almost any place else in Scripture, Galatians 3 and Romans 4. Abraham, as it started out in Galatians 3, how do you get a miracle? By hearing with faith, not by earning it. If you believe God like that, you become sons of Abraham or daughters of Abraham. You become blessed with Abraham, the believer. Then we turn to Romans 4 and we say, well, what did Abraham do? He looked at his own situation, and yet with respect to the promise, he began to give glory to God. Now, my practical admonition, and let's just finish it, and then I'm gonna give you some practicals, and then we'll pray. It says, he was fully convinced that God was able to do what he promised. That is why his faith was counted as righteousness. But the words "it was counted to him" were not written for his sake alone, but for ours also. You see, this wasn't just about Abraham. This wasn't the guy that got the heavenly lottery. It's for our sake, we're written for our sake also alone, but for ours also rather, it will be counted to us who believe in him who raised from the dead Jesus our Lord, who was delivered up for our trespasses and raised for our justification. Now, I want you to stand up with me just a minute. I want to explain this because I need you to move a little bit, and I need you to kind of get out of this mode of just staring like this is a movie here. So here's what Abraham did. He began to grow strong in faith. He began to thank God. He just began to. I think Abraham probably walked around and said, Lord, I just thank you. In fact, it's not that he didn't want to look at his wife or look at himself. He said, Lord, the more I look at these situations, the more I look at the circumstances, worse it gets. And God gave him a picture. He said, look to the stars, look to the sand. So Abraham could not open up to Romans 4, but he began to look up and he began to give thanks. So close your eyes as you stand here tonight, and I want you to lock in on a promise. I want you to lock in on one promise. Now, if you're going to learn to get prayers answered, I've heard it said like this. Find the scripture you're standing on. Find some verse. Let's just take one verse tonight. Let's just take God has not given you a spirit of fear. Anybody in this room dealing with the spirit of fear? Anybody dealing with the spirit of fear? Okay, close your eyes, and I want you to begin to thank God. Begin to lift your hands and say, Lord, I thank you tonight. Begin to whisper this. I thank you tonight that you have not given me the spirit of fear. but of power, love, and a sound mind. Father in heaven, I thank you tonight that right now in this place, we're going to begin to thank you that though we may feel afraid, Lord, we are trusting that your promise of deliverance from fear is greater than what we feel. Hallelujah. Just begin to thank him now. Just begin to say, thank you, Jesus. Just begin to thank him now as with your hands raised. Lord, we thank you tonight that though we may feel sick in our body, Lord, we trust that by your very stripes we are healed. You said in Psalm 103 that you are to forget, we are to forget none of your benefits. You pardon all our iniquities. You heal all our diseases. So begin to thank him. Say, Lord, I thank you that you heal all my diseases. Begin to say that. Say, Lord, I thank you that you heal all my diseases. Thank you for that, Lord. Thank you for that, Jesus. Thank you. Just begin to lift your voice. Come on back, my music, my piano player. Just begin to thank him right now. Lord, we thank you tonight. We give you thanks. We give you thanks. Don't just clap. Let your words do the clapping. Let your words do the vocalize your thanks. Vocalize your thanks. Begin to say, thank you, Jesus, that you have given me a gift of righteousness. Just begin to thank him tonight that you have been made righteous. That's everything tonight. Whatever you're facing tonight, you don't have to go it alone. You're not standing miles outside of the heavenly throne room. You have been given access to come boldly into the throne of grace. So let's step into the throne of grace tonight. Hebrews chapter 4 says, come boldly into the throne of grace. Just take a step forward and say, Lord, I thank you tonight that I am right with you, that I can come right into the very presence of God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for this faith of Abraham, that he didn't grow weary, he didn't grow weak in his faith, but he grew strong in faith, giving you glory. Just begin to say thank you. Just begin to say thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Just hold your clapping and just thank him. Just thank him. Just say thank you, Jesus. As Pastor Philip said, those who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Just begin to say thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your promises. Thank you, Father, for the promise for my family. Just begin to think about the promises for your family. What promises are you standing on for your children? You say none in particular. Well, find something. Abraham had to consider the promise or else the problem would have overwhelmed him. Lord, I thank you that you said that Isaiah 54, that all of my children would be taught of the Lord and great would be the peace of my children, Isaiah 54. Just begin to lock in and say, Lord, I thank you for the promise for my children. Just begin to thank him for it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, thank you that we can trust tonight that we're righteous. No matter what we've done, no matter what our sins, no matter what the burdens we carry, Lord, thank you that you have called us sons and daughters. And because of the resurrection of Jesus, we are justified. Think about it. You've been justified just as if you'd never sinned. Justified just as if I'd never sinned. We're righteous tonight, holy tonight. It says that by one sacrifice, he has made holy all those who believe. So tonight, you're not trying to be holy. You are holy. He has made you holy. He has made you righteous. Thank you, God. Father, I'm asking tonight that you would lift this unbelief, the words that we've heard, Lord, the multitude of words that come into our minds that compete with the words of the promise. Lord, help us to turn aside, even as these precious ones have turned aside tonight to listen. And listen, as you're standing, you're going to have to feed on this. Go back tonight, Galatians 3, Romans chapter 4. Lord, I don't understand it, but you've made me righteous. You did something that was a gift. You gave it to me. You gave me a gift of righteousness. You said, I'm blessed if I'm not because of I've earned it, but because I've even all the sins I've committed, you've blessed me in spite of it all. Lord, let that revelation of this is a blessed people, that we don't have to do anything other than to receive what you've promised. Now, Lord, I'm asking that from a place of righteousness, we would begin to cry out for those around us, because beyond our children and our families and our marriages, Lord, we are surrounded by people with need. Everywhere we turn, listen, 360 degrees around your house, around your job, are people that are desperate. They have no hope and they're without God in the world. Practically, Lord, I'm asking that you would begin to use us as a people to be able to share this faith and to begin not just to tell facts, but Lord, to begin to share hope with people. Lord, to pray for people, to pray for miracles to happen, to preach this promise to them and tell them that there's a God who came to this earth, that died on a cross and rose from the dead, that offers them a full and complete pardon. People are mad at the president because he forgave a bunch of people that didn't deserve it. Listen, there's a pardon far greater than any president could give anybody. It's a full and complete pardon from all your sins, from all your transgressions, from all your past. Lord, just put it in our minds, the people that we need to pray for. Just lock into one person that you know that needs prayer. I'm locking in right now, Lord. I'm locking in to the people that I encounter that I know need you. I was thinking of, we were at Michigan State just a few months ago, and we had, in two meetings, we've had over 1,000 students that attended, and there was this one student that after the event came up to me and began to talk, and he was just so confused and he had so many doubts. Gave him a God's Not Dead book, and as I began to talk to him and just planted the seed, I just found out today, this friend of mine called and said, you know, that guy got saved. He's now one of the leaders on campus. Abraham didn't see what was promised, but something happened. You see, he was still old and his wife was still old, but there was a promise made. And when we plant the seed, something happens. A few months ago, Pastor James and I were doing a wedding, and on a Saturday night, the wedding was Saturday night, but that Saturday morning we had done the rehearsal dinner the night before, and I got up and I brought my Bible into the little area, the little coffee shop at the hotel where we were all staying with the bridal party, and there was a businessman sitting there, and he saw my Bible, and he said, is that a Bible? And I said, yeah, it's a Bible. And I had my much bigger Bible, and so he goes, oh, I need the Bible. So I sat there and I said, well, tell me why. And he said, nobody would believe my story. I said, well, give me a chance. I'll try me. So long story short, he said, you know, when I was 21 years old, and by this time his wife came up and sat by him, he said, I was in my father's basement. And he said, I accidentally was gripped by a wire, and he said, I was being shocked and I couldn't get away from it. He said, it locked me in. What kind of current is that, JT? Is that, 110? I mean, but what? I thought when you got near electricity, it kind of blew you away, but what is it that locks you in? 110? And he said, I felt myself leaving my body. He said, all of a sudden, he said, I was looking down on the place. He said, I was in my parents' basement, the windows were down, the shades were down, the doors were locked, and now he's dying. And he begins to describe this out-of-body experience where he's going up and up, and he said he got all the way to this light that he knew was heaven, and he said this figure came out, and he said it was both joyful and fearful all at the same time. Now, by this time, Pastor James had come up to sit with us. And he said, I stood in the presence of this being. I knew it was God. And he said, I don't know how long it was. He said, but the next thing I knew, I was on my parents' front lawn, and they were shocking me back to life. They had the paddles on his chest. He said, and his wife, look, he said, we had no idea how, in that moment with the windows down and all that, how somebody got in there and got us out and got the paramedics there. But he said, I was being shocked back to life. And he said, he looked at me, he said, for 30 years, he said, I've had one question in my mind. And he said, the question was, why didn't he let me into heaven? He said, because really, I wanted to go in. And so I'm sitting there at the coffee shop. I've got my Bible open. I said, well, what would you have told him if he asked you, why should I let you in? And he said, I don't know. He didn't actually say that. He kind of said, I won't say it like he said it. He says, heck, I don't know. And I took the Bible and I began to lead him through some similar passages that I just led you through. And it was hard for him to understand, because he said he was raised Catholic, that somehow he didn't know what he needed to do to earn it. And I basically said, this is all about what was done for you, and will you believe it? And I actually had a picture when I'm not Catholic, obviously, but I'd given Pope Francis a book. And so since he was Catholic, I pulled it up. I said, I looked at the picture of the Pope and me. I said, you see these two? I said, you see me with this fellow here? I said, neither of us would get into heaven on anything we've done. Nothing we've done would qualify us. I said, it comes down to putting the weight of your trust in Christ. And then he and his wife were sitting there, and I just said, you know, because we had a wedding that night, but this was almost like, I said, grab your wife's hand. I said, are you ready to put the weight of your trust in the one who died on the cross and rose from the dead? I said, everything that he wants to do for you starts this way. You just have to hear and believe. And then walk this sweet little couple through this prayer. I went to bring my wife coffee. When I got back, he was wanting to buy my hotel room. I said, I don't need you to buy my, you do not need to buy my hotel room. It is all, it's like, yeah, I know Jesus gave me a free gift, but let me bless you. No, you don't need, no. And I gave him the Bible, and I left him. I left him just basically standing up and saying, now I know what to say. The next time I get there into the presence of God. But it isn't just when we die one day and go into the presence. It's when we stand in prayer. What do we say? I'm coming to you tonight on the basis of the name of Jesus. Not my works, not how much I prayed, not how much I deserve it. I'm coming to you tonight on the basis of the work of Christ. Thank you for this gift of righteousness, this free gift. Close your eyes one more time, because I'm going to stop. Lord, I'm asking tonight that this people would come into your presence, boldly into your presence, and trust you. Lord, I thank you for all the things that you've been merciful to be about. Lord, all the challenges that face us. Lord, none of us could stand on the basis of our merits. But we put our trust in you tonight. If you need to put your trust in tonight, whoever you are, not just to be saved, but you say, tonight I'm putting my trust completely in him. Just lift our hands tonight. And then as these hands are raised, we're saying, Lord, we put our trust in you. We put our trust in you tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Just a little bit more, just one more moment of thanking him. This is like kind of trying to get the car started. Some of you, it's just a little bit tough. It's just been, your spirit's just a little bit somber because you're just not used to doing it. But Lord, may you awaken your people. Awake unto righteousness and sin not. Lord, we get free from sin by being awakened to righteousness. We reign in life in righteousness through Christ. Through the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, we reign in life. Lord, you've called these men and women in this room to be more than conquerors, not in their own strength, not because of their background, but because of the gift of righteousness that is given to us in Christ. And Lord, even as Abraham believed you, may we begin to, listen, let's look at me. Just begin to get your Bible. Find that real Bible, not the digital one with all the competition. Find one and begin to mark it up. Begin to walk your floor at night. Begin to circle those promises and hold them before God. Lord, I hold your promises before your people. Even as the Apostle Paul prayed for the church and said, I pray that the eyes of their heart may be opened so that they may know the hope to which they're called and the riches of your glorious inheritance in the saints and the exceeding greatness of your power toward us who believe. Lord, this is in accordance with the working of your mighty power, which you brought about in Christ when you raised him from the dead and raised him up far above all principality and power and dominion and every name that is named. And you gave him to the church, which is your body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us. Lord, as this power gets at work within us, you said you're able to do beyond what we ask or think. Do that for this people. Lord, may prayers be answered this week. May loved ones be healed this week. May miracles open doors happen in every place that they go. Lord, may this midweek service be a marker of where something significant happened, where we decided to follow the faith of Abraham just to believe what we hear. And Lord, may we turn our ears this week, the rest of this week, towards your word. May we incline our ears to what your promises say. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I'm going to give the Lord a shout. You can join me. Hallelujah.
If you've watched this message and you want to make Jesus Lord of your life, I've got good news. You can do it right now. I want you to pray with me. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my life for the rest of my life. I acknowledge I am a sinner. I need you, my Savior. I believe you died for me. I believe you were raised from the dead on the third day. And I confess that you are now Lord of my life. If you've just prayed that prayer, I have good news for you. You have eternal life. The next step for you is to get in a Bible-believing church. We volunteer to be that church. But if not us, we pray God's blessings on you as you search for God's best for you. Thank you.
Bethel World Outreach Church, reaching a city to touch the world.